Yeah, probably.
But it would pay me well, it would pay me so well.
Yeah. The review hasn't yet done it yet.
Yeah, review it too, still.
Review is lost the password to get to impossible website. And then I've got one.
Yeah. There's one journalist down east, and we still need a lot of people to please don't use email. It's a pretty much like a journal. I know that things can be revised.
And some of them you can submit it through the board, but there are many some in the library. No, it's you can write the board. Most you get is that the basic amount is like you can get things out of standard two line in the
calculations
plus.
Okay, everyone, I think we'll have a start. Welcome. I am Daniela Duca, and I work in the research team within JISC. And what we are doing today is we're celebrating our research data champions. So these are researchers that have been promoting their work and best practices around research data management within their groups and as well as outside. So they've done quite a few things, and we'll hear from some of them today. So before we start, I will have a few logistics, I guess, to say is that as far as I know, there's no fire alarm scheduled. So if the fire goes up, then follow me. Internal toilets, so for you to go to the toilet, you have to go to Paul at the reception and get a fob, and the toilets are upstairs, and you need the fob to go through the doors. We'll have lunch, and we'll also have drinks, and we are live streaming this, so there is a link circulating probably. So smile for the camera. So the agenda is we will start with Andy, then we'll hear from a few of the research data champions. There's one little change in the agenda that our research data champion from St. Andrews wasn't able to come. So I will talk to you about research data shared service. after lunch, we'll hear from Andrea about something that we've been developing, which is a research data toolkit, and will be launched or available within the next month. And he'll show you a little preview of what that's going to be like, what's going to have, and we welcome questions. And then we'll have a little panel with our research data champions to have a discussion following the presentation. Then we'll have some drinks. And that will be the end of the day. However, there are some, we have this whole area. So in the rooms next door, we'll have Andrew, who will be running some little workshops. So if you're interested in how they've done it at Cambridge in terms of mentoring and so on, then he's going to be there to talk through it. And so for tweeting, if you are tweeting, use RDCD, Research Data Champions Day, or just RDM. And we're live streaming on YouTube on our Research Data Futures channel. So that's it for me. So if you have any questions or you don't find something, come find me. Otherwise, I think we will start with the presentations. So Andy.
Which camera are we using? So this was originally going to be titled Fair Data Dinkum Science, but I didn't want to get too Australian, so I changed it to just science. Well, I changed it from science to research, because, you know, in the Anglophone, these two things mean slightly different things. So you can get the talk presentation slides from that link, and that's how you reference it. And I've gone about collecting some images from the web to make it a little bit more colourful and less black and white. This is the outline of the talk, so we're going to do a bit of getting to know each other, find out who's here, some background to what FAIR Data and Dinkum Research might be, just research, and some key points and then some plans. And you'll see that there's a little progress bar at the bottom, which I gathered when we were in Cambridge. So, I'm a geographer, I come from a maths background, and I'm based at the University of Leeds. So I'm going to wonder who's here. So there is the live stream, that's a link to the channel there. And this is a periodic table of disciplines, so geography somewhere over here. You might find your own discipline on there. But I was wondering how diverse we are as a group. Who our employers are, whether we're all from universities. Can you put your hand up if you're not from a university? So there's one person here who's not from, are you from GIS?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so that's us. We're all I guess, from universities, apart from the people from GIS in the room, but I don't know who's watching online. So I don't know who we're reporting to and representing, so most of us, I guess, research data champions. Actually, less than most of us are research data champions. So what roles do we have that are relevant to today in this keynote? So who's in administration and library? Okay, so look around and see who's who. So I do some work with ethics and data management, but worked it up with our library. Who's the researcher? Who does research? So that involves various different bits. So we've got data assimilation, processing, and reviewing work. So do you all do a bit of those things? And presumably you've got to apply for grants and everything else. Who does teaching as well? Does anybody teach about research data management? So, anybody supervise research students? So here's another view of academic disciplines. Got another nice picture there. So you can look at all the different types of academic disciplines that there are, and there's an academic discipline for just about everything. Here's a view of sciencey stuff. So this side of the diagram here links to this side of the diagram here. Someone's created a pithy picture with humanities there. But this is kind of science focused, and it doesn't involve so much to do with arts. I don't know if music's on there. We'll be hearing that.
So my background, I specialise in computational geography, so I'm trying to create that crystal ball that tells us what our future is. And I've been doing it for about 20 years. And during which time I've been, and still am, an open science advocate. Everybody heard of the term open science? Very fashionable, but has everybody heard of the term closed science? It's kind of not there, is it? There's no such thing. Back in the day, we called it e-science. E standing for electronic, I think, originally, but then it was like enhanced, like enabling. Like, what can we do that we couldn't do before with this connected web of data? And when they moved that to Australia, they termed it e-research because they realised that the science term immediately put off quite a lot of people, including those in social science. But certainly the arts and humanities were kind of a little bit left out, so they called it e-research. So I'm a data sharing evangelizer. I want people to share their data so that we can have a better base for knowledge. I'm a programmer. My speciality language is Java, just another vague acronym. But it's a very useful language. And I use development environments, building deployment tools like Maven, versioning and repositories, which are all very useful. What we do with software development quite often has been brought into what we're doing with data management. So quite a few years ago now, I helped with the setting up of a Research Data Leeds, which is our research data management service at the University of Leeds, where I also worked for 6 months as a research data advisor, working in the Faculty of Environment, which covers geography, environmental science and transport studies in the University of Leeds. I do research ethics administration, so I sit on a cross-faculty ethics committee and look at applications that involve research on human participants. So I've kind of been around for a while dealing with DISC, and I came to Cambridge and I came to York. And there's links to the various notes and stuff that I tend to write notes. And try to do that in a collaborative and open way. So the original brief for this talk was to talk about open science and research data. And I recently went to a meeting where I met John Tennant, Proto Hedgehog, who is kind of riding this wave of open science at the moment, going all around the world. Presenting and trying to encourage people to do this more open practice for science. At a knowledge exchange workshop, which is an organisation which covers at the moment about 6 countries. So there's Denmark, France, Germany, Holland, the Netherlands, the UK and Finland. And there it was, this sticker was presented to me. They had lots of stickers, lots of ways of sort of didn't get one on my laptop, but I will get one at some point. But open science is just science done right, that's what John said, and then somebody made a sticker, and that's what I said. So there's a link there to some definitions of what open science is. And is it a thing, is it a movement, what is it? We debated that at this knowledge exchange event. And practically took steps to think about how we could open up the research process. Who's not heard of the Panton Principles, which was named after a pub in Cambridge, where a friend of mine from eScience days, Cameron Nayland, was there with some others. And he was one of the reasons why I really wanted to call it Fair Data Dinkum Science to start with, because he's got an Australian accent. Links there to the notes from that. Let's talk about FAIR data principles, or just remind ourselves what it is. So FAIR, findable, accessible, interoperable, reusable. And this is from the Force 11 Group's webpage on FAIR principles. So we've got 4 main things to do with it being findable. Unique IDs, good metadata, registered somewhere so that those things can share all that information about where it is. And specify the data. accessible. So two main parts to that. So the metadata can be retrieved by others. It's a standardized communication protocol for getting those data. And that protocol is free and openly and universally implementable. And we can deal with AAA, as we call it back in the day, authentication, authorization, access. So interoperable, what does that mean? Well, interoperable is really important. It means that other things can recognize and work with that thing. So it uses quite, it uses these standards for information exchange. Reusable, just because you've put something out there doesn't mean to say it's easy to use. So you can make it easier to use, not only just with your example of your usage of it, but by making very good documentation that others can find and apply it to some other use. And this is another thing that I got from the Knowledge Exchange. Really what FAIR Data is summarised is it's as open as possible but as closed as necessary. And the reason why it's kind of a better term than open is because it deals with this plurality of sensitive data. Not all data can be open data. Sometimes not all parts of what we're doing in science or in research can be open. To be embargoed for a time sometimes, but sometimes it just really can't be disseminated in an open way. So in that case, it's more closed. It's not open, so it is closed, but then there are barriers to accessing it, but those barriers we try to make as low as possible. So the origins of open science, and a lot of this stuff goes back to the 60s actually, when we were looking at peer review changes and layered journals and preprints. Yeah, these things have been about for a long time, but in the Antarctic Treaty, there was a requirement there in Article 3 that observations and results must be made freely available. So this has been going on for a long time, but that predates the web, of course. Reproducible research, what does that mean? So making it easy for somebody to be able to recreate the workflow and enact the workflow of your research. So it's about these main things. I've bolded up key parts of that. So, and this again comes from slides that are out there from somewhere else. But how do I get your data? How do I use it? How do I trust it? How do I build on it? And what am I allowed to do with it? What's the licensing conditions for that data? And in research, we're not just dealing with data, we're dealing with things that change data. So the same thing is kind of true with code. Our code management. And a lot of reproducible research is really about the computational elements of reproducibility, but this really can cover other things. But the code part is really when we're dealing with computational processes. But how do I get your code? The stuff that changed your input data into your output data. How do we use it? How do I trust it? It does what it does. And there, open source is key. How do I build on your code? Same, open source is key. And what am I allowed to do with your code? Well, open source licensing will tell you that you can access it and you can use it, but then there's also, what are you allowed to do with it? How can you change it? How can you reuse that code, fold it into other things? What do you have to do in order to do it? So licenses are key. They're really important things that help us to build knowledge. So a lot of what's happened to happen is to open up and kind of revolutionise scholarly communication, but this is why the web was invented, and it had to change everything else almost before it changed this one thing that it was really made to do. But revolutions do take a long time sometimes. You know, the Industrial Revolution wasn't just like a snap thing that happened. The Information Revolution has taken a while. And the revolution in scholarly communications is still maybe in its early phases, but people are opening up peer review process so that you can make a pledge that you'll try to do this thing and you can try to encourage it. But what is it? Open peer review is, rather than the review happening without you putting your name to it, you can put your name to your review and your review can be reviewed. It's start opening up all of the parts of this scholarly communication process, which will hopefully reduce the amounts of corruption may exist within it. So we're not alone. There's various different organisations that we can work with to achieve our aims on this and to achieve them globally. So what are my plans? Well, I've got various research data management case studies at Leeds. I've got friends who are emeritus staff who've left the university, but I've got a copy of their data, and I'm trying to push that into our repository. And so part of my research data champion work is to try to follow through on some of that work and help other people have a legacy of their research that they've done throughout their life. I'm trying to create a bit of a research data audit following the digital asset framework and methodology to find out what data we've got and that the university curates and looks after, or maybe doesn't curate and look after, but try to bring that into the process of curation and sharing. At the same time, I'm trying to advocate research data best practices, or good practices, and lead by example. And so maybe, as the first keynote I've ever given, I'm going to start riding this open science wave and perhaps get some far from place and tell other people about it. A summary slide here. So it's a bit like a setting sun, but it's not. It's a sun. So science, you know, is part of fair research, but there's more to fair research than just science. And there's more to fair research than what we have in the generation of knowledge and understanding. Dare I say it, being wise. So here's a link to some Google Docs document that we can hopefully collaborate and develop notes on the day and get a good record of what we have discussed. Call that from other people in the room. Here's some links, nearly at the end of the talk. But I've got one last nice picture to show you before the end. And I'd just like to say thank you for this platform to say what it is that I was going to say. And to shout out to our friends in Cardiff who are at the Collaborations Workshop. This is a Software Sustainability Institute-led effort, which is a kind of like an annual event of people who try to generate reproducible research and that meet up in a fairly unconferencey way, so who knows, they might be listening. So we lost him, but he knew what all this was about. He was a very clever person. So let's just embrace his words there. Anyone, anywhere in the world should have free, unhindered access to not just my research, but to the research of every great and inquiring mind across the spectrum of human understanding. Professor Stephen.
Thank you, Daniela, for inviting me to this. You might have to excuse some fumbling. I'm sorry, I'm not used to wearing microphones of this sort, so if I knock it off and flounder around, my apologies for that. But yes, thank you for the invitation to come in and talk today. I'm a research fellow from the Royal College of Music, and what I wanted to do today was just spend a bit of time giving a bit of background around what, I guess, research type activity we have at the RCM, And as research data champion, there are some of the work that I've been undertaking as part of this process as well. So for anybody not familiar, the Royal College of Music was founded in 1883. We're predominantly a teaching-focused institution, so I guess we are a monotechnic in the sense that we train musicians, so performers and composers in that sense. We have some research, I'm certainly a research there, my research is in psychology, and most of the research most of my research colleagues are either psychology-based or musicology, music history-based as well. So the bulk of the data that we have, the types of data that we produce and then have is standard social science, scientific type data, so that myself and my colleagues in the Center for Performance Science produce. But we also have a lot of what we refer to as heritage data as well. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that is in a minute, or what we consider that to be in a minute. Of course, with REF looming coming up, obviously we're very much being pushed by this open access agenda as well, so we're very conscious of that. We're trying to make as much of the data stuff that we have as open, as accessible as possible. But as I mentioned, the vast majority of our faculty are practice-based, so they are performing musicians themselves, and they are teaching our approximately 800 students to be performing musicians themselves, or they are composers. And therefore, many of them don't think of themselves as researchers for a start, or nor do they think of what they produce as research either. So they produce, our composers produce manuscripts, audio, video recordings of their work. Many of our performers produce recordings, of course, those kinds of things. And so there is obviously lots of different work and thought and things that go into that, and often there is not a lot of consideration of what the research aspects or angles of that might be. There are a number of different departments within the RCM, or historically they have each used their own approach to data preservation and storage here. And so part of the challenge that we've had and what we've been grappling with over the last year is trying to get these different systems aligned and get them talking to one another. So even though a lot of what is being produced at the RCM is being kept and stored somewhere, it's often being kept in each of these small different little silos. They don't speak to one another, and they're certainly not speaking to those outside of the institution as well. And so some of what I've been doing throughout this, but also in collaboration with my colleague Emma Hewitt, who is our research and knowledge exchange manager, is trying to get everything consolidated to a single system, but also getting the system to a point where everybody in the institution would be accessing it, but also people outside of the institution would be accessing it as well. So looking, I mentioned that we produce a lot of what we refer to as heritage data. Now we have one of our theaters is a Britain Theater, an opera theater, and recently underneath the theater was opened up and found that it was just boxes and boxes and boxes of old reel-to-reel film. Nobody touched these things, they were quite covered in dust. Nobody really knew what was in there. And so there was a lot of effort done in conjunction with the Research Data Management Sharing Service. We were one of the pilot institutions here. There was a real push to try and get some of this digitized and preserved in some sort of format. So, we could find out what was on it in the first instance, but then also try and preserve it should we need for some sort of future desire. But in its current state, a lot of this data, this stuff that was found, was very inaccessible. We had no idea what it was, and therefore it was a danger of being lost. And so as a result of being part of the Research Data Management Shared Service, we've had the opportunity to digitize 50 DAT tapes, 100 CDs and DVDs, 60 Betamax tapes, 100 reel-to-reels, 20 audio-video U-matic tapes, and 30 VHS tapes. So tons and tons. And to try and give you a sense of some of the stuff that was found under there, I'll show you a couple of videos. But for instance, here's Emma Towers Evans. She was one of our studio's administrators. So we have a recording studios on site. Its function is predominantly for recording student works, but they record virtually any activity, so internal, external performance or event that happens at the RCM. And so it was them who had been producing all of this stuff that had then been stored underneath one of our theaters, but they had lost track of what was under there. So even though they'd been squirreling stuff away for years and years and years, there wasn't any record of what had been squirreled away. And so over the last year or so, they've actually been trying to dig all of this back out. And so here's Emma working with one of the reel-to-reel tapes, and one of those that had been sent off for baking, so that it could be digitized. Some of these, as you can see, came with some sort of labeling. At times it was legible, at times it was not legible, at times it was damaged to the point where it couldn't be legible anymore. So even though we found all of this stuff under there, we had no idea what it was that we were dealing with and whether any of it would actually be useful or not. So just to give you a sense of some of what was there. Those of us not from Britain perhaps don't understand the significance of this perhaps, but those of you do may perhaps. So we have these kinds of things, the RCM's contributions to Blue Peter, I guess. We also have found some of this kind of thing.
Wednesday the 5th of November, to noises off from neighbouring Guy Fawkes parties, the Swellheims, the Prince of Wales, arrived at the Royal College of Music behind the Royal Albert Hall. Not unusual. Prince is a frequent visitor, but this was a very special occasion. And a few minutes later, Her Majesty the Queen arrived too. They were there to celebrate the opening of a remarkable new theatre in which students for the first time would have decent facilities for preparing and performing opera. Before officially opening the theatre, the Queen and Prince Charles met some of those most closely involved in raising money, making us all go short.
It was on for a while.
And indeed,
so this was a broadcast prepared for BBC One. And then in conjunction with that event, actually, we found this.
The Marathon is part of the Royal College's centenary appeal to raise £4 million to build not only rehearsal rooms, but also a new opera hall, as well as improve the student welfare service. This report now from Maggie Nelson.
So this is a concert hall. This is the first performance space that was built at the Royal College of Music.
In spite of its limitations, during the years the college has produced many famous musicians, including James Galway, Benjamin Britten, Gustav Holst, and Sir Arthur Bliss. And it does have some excellent facilities. This concert hall, for instance, is one of the finest in the country. But at the moment, self-help would seem to be the motto, with hundreds of the students volunteering to help out in Saturday's music marathon. And if they can't find a practice room, they're even prepared to do their rehearsals for the big day outside.
That music marathon starts at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning at the Royal College in Prince Consort Road, South Kensington. Should be quite a performance.
Okay, so other than general interest perhaps, it may be that at some point somebody wants to do some work on the history and legacy and some of the work that's led up to the development or the history of the Britain Theatre, for instance, and so this kind of archival material could actually be proved quite valuable. But in its state in which it was found, it was on the verge of crumbling, and many of the reels that were dug out did crumble when they were held. And so there's a lot of work now trying to preserve this kind of thing. We don't know if it will be useful, if it will be used, but we feel we have it, and there is a value in actually trying to preserve it for some sort of future use. But I wanted to spend a little bit of time, and I'm going to be asking you some questions about this as well, talking about some work that I do at the Royal College of Music. So we have a unique facility called our performance simulator. So we've recreated a musical performance space, and the idea with this is we want to give our music students the opportunity to practice performing. Obviously, they spend a lot of time practicing. Many of them are hopefully quite good at practicing. They don't necessarily get many opportunities to actually give live performances. Obviously, the logistics of hiring a hall, recruiting an audience, all of those kinds of things is quite logistically challenging. And so building upon some work from colleagues in the Faculty of Medicine at Imperial College, we wanted to try to reproduce or recreate elements of the musical performance process so that our students could get opportunities or experiences practicing this process of performing. And by abstracting it and capturing and controlling it, we also have an opportunity to turn it into a learning and teaching opportunity and tool as well. So just to give you a bit of a sense of, this isn't really a mock-up of the space that we have, but students will often be given a green room where they can warm up, to then enter into the backstage area. It's small, dark, and shabby, much like many live backstage areas. where they're greeted by a backstage manager who essentially acts as technician as well. The musician can do whatever it is they need to do while they're warming up, getting ready to go when they're in this backstage area. And when they are ready, and when the backstage manager has determined with their front of house staff that the audience is in, doors are closed, the musician can then enter through the doors and enter into our stage space. We have a projection of different types of interactive audiences, so we have larger audiences, but we also have smaller audition panels that can listen and respond in different kinds of ways to the performances. You know, so we've tried to build in different pieces of the performance environment, strap those down and recreate them into a way that musicians can still move through the performance process. Is this going to... Let's see if this one projects. All right, so we've lost it. Getting ready to play. Which goes for the next 13 minutes. As I said, this space was set up predominantly as a teaching and learning opportunity for our students. As you can obviously see here, we have the capacity to video and audio record all performances in the space so that they are then uploaded to our intranet, our virtual learning environment, so that students can then watch those back and reflect on them afterwards. So my question to you then, what data do you see out of this, or what data do you think can be extracted out of this?
So I'm a psychologist, so I can think of quite a few things. So you can obviously code the behavior or the quality of the performance from these videos.
Mm-hmm.
But it also makes me think that you could look at other things like physiological signals. You know, you could wire people up to look at other. I'm just thinking about other experiments.
Have you heard about this? Have you listened to this before?
No, okay. No. It's just the first thing that jumped into my head.
Excellent. Good. Okay. Well, keep going, and I won't have to say much afterwards.
Oh, sorry, I'll stop.
No. That's
fine. There's other contexts where I can think we've done experiments not with music, but in
mm-hmm.
other social contexts where you know you'd wire people up or
mm-hmm.
you'd look at other social signals or other kind of things that might hint nervousness
mm-hmm.
or. And that might be useful feedback to students, but
mm.
from a psychological perspective, it would be interesting to see how that compares to a real concert event
mm.
to see if you get the same physiological response.
Mm.
Yeah. So.
And there was some of that work done in the validation of this space.
Cool.
Yeah, good. So the video itself obviously can represent a source of data, and there's lots of work that could be done with this around the evaluation of it, certainly. There's lots that can be done. Well, maybe if I can come back to that other point, yeah. What else? What else could be extracted out of this? So there's the video itself, but perhaps if it's easier, think about the larger process of somebody going through this space as well. Okay, well, maybe I'll build a bit more on what it is you're saying there. Okay, so there's the video itself, absolutely, and so there's lots that we can do with that video. So we can evaluate the quality of it, perhaps. That isn't something that we do with these videos, as I say. This is predominantly a teaching and learning tool, so students will perform in this space to get ready for their then assessed performances. But we could use, and well, in fact, we do use the performance simulator as outcome as an, or performance as indicator as outcome variables for different types of training or interventions if we want to look at the efficacy of some of our modules or programs that we offer or other types of interventions that we offer alongside it. And so we do run a number of studies in which performances in the simulator are an outcome variable. So we can look at the quality of those kinds of things, for instance. We have a lot of research going on at the moment, and as I say, we're very interested in trying to capture things when people are in this space as well. So obviously the audio and video recordings are a big part of that, but we're also interested in how people move. And we're interested in looking at how that movement corresponds to stress, for instance, levels of stress, but also levels of expertise. And so we have a project running at the moment called Technology-Enhanced Learning of Musical Instrument Performance, which is trying to find different ways of capturing movement from basic video footage. So this is not in our performance simulator at the moment, but this is done by some work at the University of Genoa. This is actually done using fairly basic video, and they're actually developing algorithms to be able to work and process that video data to start capturing movement data here. And so we have this system set up in our performance simulator at the moment. And so the idea with this is we want to be able to extract these kinds of images to be able to give the students so that they have a better understanding of how they move, what they do with their body, how that affects or how that is affected by things like stress, fatigue, levels of expertise, all of those kinds of things. And so the idea with this, although there's a lot of work and research going into the development of it to develop the algorithms and validate the algorithms, the idea ultimately is that this will ultimately become a self-running tool that students can then use in order to get their own insight or in order to get greater levels of self-awareness and understanding. And so at the moment, everything that is being produced through the use of this is being very much held as data. But the idea is that ultimately it will just run and be a function of the simulator so that students can just click a button and see these kinds of things. And so it won't necessarily be captured for any research purpose. But obviously, this kind of data very much has a lot of interest for researchers as well. And so we're looking at how do we capture kind of things that are just produced as sort of byproducts as a result of learning and teaching activities that we have in the world of culture music. For instance, we're doing work with, as part of this Tell Me project, with an Xbox Kinect down here. And so what you're looking at here, there are three markers placed along this violinist's bow. So the nut at the end, both ends of the bow, and then right in the middle as well. And so this is tracking the movement of it. And so this was at a demonstration that was done at a conference in Reykjavik in Iceland back in August. This is a concertmaster of the Icelandic National Orchestra and one of her students. And they came to try out this the software, so the Kinect and then the motion tracking capabilities that are being used through the Kinect. Just to have a little video here. So this is the teacher working with the student. So there wasn't a lot to see there, but the student was working on what's referred to as a string crossing exercise. And the emphasis of this string crossing was to try and maintain as smooth a bow throughout this whole process as possible. But what this video captured, which is probably a bit hard to show, it's just the excitement from the teacher, and they were speaking in Icelandic, which I don't speak, but apparently the smoothness of the bow crossing in this particular exercise was something that this teacher had been working with the student for quite some time, but through standard teaching practices hadn't been able to really help the student understand just what it was she was actually doing in terms of the movement of the bow. But by visualizing it then, the student was actually able to see what it was that the teacher was talking about. And so at one point, at that point there, the teacher said, "Stop, do you see what you're doing here? This is what I'm talking about." And so this is part of what the Tell Me project is looking at doing, is finding different ways of capturing musical performance, reproducing and visualizing it to aid in this learning and teaching tool. And so again, the idea is that once the system is up and running, it will just run so that students or teachers can bring their students in, capture this kind of thing to use as a teaching tool. So again, it'll be producing lots of data, lots of stuff, not explicitly for research purposes, but again, it will very much have a lot of value for research purposes if we can capture it and keep it in some sort of usable format. Now, you were mentioning, could we not just wire up performers while they're in the space? Yes, we do. So we have, in the past, used a system called BioHarness, made by a company called BioNomatics. What you're looking at here is a printout from the BioHarness. So at the top here is an ECG trace, so the heart rate. So the red line is the ECG trace. This black line here is respiration. And then it also captures things like skin temperature, displacement of the body, different types of movement as well. And so we are very interested in capturing this kind of thing for a couple of reasons. On the one hand, we're interested in capturing this kind of data so that our students can understand a little bit more about themselves and how they function when they're under stress, for instance. So physiologically, what do they look like when they're performing? As you say, we're interested in differences between when they're in our simulator, for instance, and when they're in live performance as well, and we want to contrast those kinds of things. And we don't capture this just to say to our students, aha, you're stressed, but to say, physiologically, this is what you look like. What is your interpretation of this? How might we be able to convert this into something facilitative as well? And so a lot of my use of this equipment, for instance, is just within a teaching capacity, so I can show students what it is that they're like physiologically when they are performing, and then use that as a teaching and learning tool as well. But again, it's producing a lot of data of what physiologically our students are like when they're in the performance simulator. Of course, we make use of a lot of standard questionnaires as well, so things like self-efficacy levels, state anxiety. We do a lot of stuff around getting students to identify and then rate performance skills that they feel they have and would like. And so in terms of data capturing and preservation, this kind of stuff is pretty straightforward. This converts into numerical responses, so it's easy keeping this in just basic spreadsheets. But again, a lot of the times we use this is for self-awareness among the students, although if we're getting down to this level of questionnaire use, we'll probably be collecting this as part of research activities as well. So all of this to say that there's a lot of stuff that we can capture and that we do regularly capture when students come through, but often it's being captured for teaching and learning purposes as opposed to research. And yet it's being produced in quite vast quantities. And so trying to find ways of actually managing this data in some sort of useful format is increasingly of interest to us. Of course, all of that's just once the students actually get to the performance simulator. But of course, a lot of our students, as I say, do a lot of practicing. And so to try and manage, fundamentally our room booking process, we use a tool called Azimut. Now, Azimut is our room booking system, but all students' activities now are booked through Azimut. So anytime they book a practice room, anytime they have a lesson or a rehearsal or an academic class, all of that is done through this Azimut system here. And so what we're finding actually is that so much of the students' activity is being sort of tracked and managed through Azimut. At last count, I think we were getting around 18,000, just over 18,000 data entry points per month based on students' activities. And each of it is logged, as you can see by ID here, each of it is logged according to students. And so we're getting around 200,000, and this was several months ago now, so I'm sure it's a little bit higher. We're getting about 200,000 data points around students' activities per year. So if we want to understand how much practicing it is that they're doing, or what types of activities are they doing leading up to their simulated performances, for instance, we have all of that data that's just being tracked as a result, or that data that's being collected through our room booking system as well. Now the challenge with this is that this is being set up and used as a room booking system, not a data capturing tool. And so the students, what we're finding is that the students haven't given us leave or assent or consent yet to actually use this as data. So now this is changing our understanding of how or what sort of consent we collect from students when they come. So all of our students have to sign consent that any images or videos used or captured of them when they're at the college can be used for marketing purposes. But we're now looking at building in consent so that any of this type of activity that's being, or data that's being produced about them, we can also use for data purposes as well. Because again, it's proving to be a vast data source as well. We have a new virtual learning environment, so we use something called Canvas, which at the RCM we call Learn. And so all of the students' work, academic work, but also increasingly a lot of their performance-based work is being logged within our VLE as well. And so again, what we're finding actually is that there's a lot of different types of work and activity that's being put onto our VLE that can be fed into our understanding of how it is that they're actually performing as well. And so on the one hand, students were just interested in being able to keep some of the stuff because they were interested in keeping their essays, or they do a lot of reflections, different kinds of things. Performances are also kept on here as well. And so students wanted to be able to keep this this stuff from year to year. We're also recognizing now that this also represents a great data source for us too. And actually we have a few projects that are running, research projects that are running in response to trying to sort of mine data out of Learn as well. And so again, this was set up initially with it being a teaching and learning tool as opposed to a research or data tool. And so again, now we're having to change how we look at it, how it functions, how we store this kind of thing, but what sort of consent we get from students in order to be able to capture and draw things out of this as well. And so what we found, we started looking at, say, just the performance area, but what we're finding is that actually there are a tremendous amount of activities that students engage with or things that students are doing throughout their time at the Royal College of Music, much of which is producing stuff that could be considered data as well. So it's really making us rethink what it is that is being produced and how we can actually capture, store, and make use of that. So all of this has led us into, as I say, a number of questions around how we deal with all of these kinds of things. We're producing lots of data, but how and why should we collect and store it? So with our VLE, for instance, we're relatively early on in our use of Canvas so that there's enough capacity within the system that we can just sort of keep storing everything that's being produced. But very quickly now, we're moving all of that stuff, that data out of Canvas itself and onto another repository so that we can keep it. But should we bother keeping any of these questions? Of course, it may be that in 20 years' time, there may be artists who have now attained superstar status. And so researchers are going to be interested in looking back at some of the things that these superstars did as part of the training. So if we can keep records of their training and their experiences and their activities when they're at the college, this could potentially, in 20 years' time, be very interesting for researchers. So we collect lots, but should we keep it all? Of course, the key questions are how and why should we be keeping it? So again, we're not historically a research-focused institution in this sense, so we haven't previously had a lot of capacity for data management and data storage, so this is really pushing us into thinking about how we can be doing that. Of course, where do we put all this stuff and store it and in what format? So one of the things we're very interested in is future-proofing our data as well. So certainly with the heritage data that the studios has literally unearthed from under one of our performance spaces, we're very interested in putting that in some sort of format that can be future-proofed for future generations. But of course, we're also interested in, just as Andy was talking about, how can this data be found? But more importantly, perhaps, how can it be accessed both by people in the institution, but also people external to the institution as well? And so trying to understand the formats of that are required and structures and regulations and everything else to be able to ensure open access as much as possible as well. But going through this process and trying to answer these kinds of questions has raised the interesting question of what function might this data actually have. As I say, a lot of it's being collected for teaching and learning purposes, but we're starting to recognize the real research value that a lot of this data has as well, if we look at it as research data and if we can collect and store it in some sort of accessible format as well, that it is actually having a lot of research type value too. So if we can understand the function that the data has, that can then feed into addressing a lot of these other questions for us as well. So just to try and sum up a little bit, we just concluded a four-year AHRC-funded project that was looking at the health and well-being of music students. And this is just one of the data management pages that was produced as a result of trying to make sense of all this data. So one of the things that we wanted to do as a result of this project was try and make the entire data set openly accessible as possible. So this was one of the strands of that data. There were 480 participants within this data set, of which there were 320 different data points collected on each of them. I can't do the maths, but I think that equated to hundreds of thousands of data points. And so with all of these participants, with these 360 different data sets, or data points for each participant, then it's resulting in us really having to think about how we actually manage, not just collect the data, but also manage the metadata about those data sets as well, and trying to develop some sort of templates and consistency. And so this is where we're at the RCM now, is actually getting all of the research active staff, but also departments speaking to one another and trying to get commonalities and consistencies in terms of how we actually set up and manage our meta-analysis. Our meta-analyses as well, so that we can actually we'll keep track of the data sets, but also make sense of these data sets in the future. And what the challenge that we have, like other institutions, I'm sure, is that when a funded project ends, we lose a lot of the staff associated with that project. And those staff obviously have a lot of the knowledge around what is in that data set. And so we're trying to make sure that the details of that data set are kept so that future researchers can then go back in and access it. Or certainly external researchers can go and make sense of that data set as well. And so we're having to fill out templates for how we keep track of our meta-analyses of the data, just to keep track of all of this kind of thing. Okay, so that was quite a quick snapshot of some of what it is that we do and some of the questions that we're grappling with. Did anybody have any questions about that?
Have you thought about or tracked how the collection and change in use of data changes the way that students interact with the system? So if someone said to me, here's your space
mm-hmm.
to put your reflections in, to put your learning in, it's private, it's yours,
mm-hmm.
and someone said to me, here's a space and it's going to get mined and used for all sorts of stuff, I would use those spaces completely differently.
Mm-hmm.
So the question about what is data and should everything become data
mm-hmm.
has implications, I think, for how
mm-hmm.
your students and staff will interact with those systems. So I'm just wondering if that's part of your conversation.
It's definitely part of the conversation, yeah. So it hasn't gotten to the point yet where we've started mining data out of the... we have been doing some basic analytics on student use of the data. So that, to date, has not... So the students are aware that we're doing analytics on that, but we haven't mined actual content out of it yet. Because, largely for those reasons, is that it was set up as a teaching and learning system first, and so we're very mindful of the fact that what students are putting on there is assessed material, and so we want to make sure that, first and foremost, that they feel comfortable with doing that. And so, yeah, we're still at conversation stage around how we discuss those kinds of things. Well, and we're discussing it with the students as well. And we have a number of students, so as I say, we have projects running around student interaction and with our VLE, and so work that goes into those modules, those parts of the VLE, students are explicitly aware that anything that goes on is to be used for research purposes as well. Now, in terms of how that material that's being uploaded differs from regular material, we haven't seen any great differences in that yet. And then, to be fair, we've just been sort of scratching the surface at it. But again, those are other issues as well. A lot of this stuff that's being produced is for one explicit purpose, so teaching and learning assessments, those kinds of things. And yeah, if we start to look at it as data, obviously that could change the nature of what it is that students are putting up there, so we're very mindful of not tampering with that. Yeah. Thank you.
Consent's quite often sort of iterative process. So you've got this registration process of the students at which you say, we're going to collect loads of data about you and use it in these different ways.
Mm-hmm.
I know that at the University of Leeds, we've thought about studying our mm-hmm. students and as a microcosm of their learning, how many times do they go for the library gates, what do they eat, how often do they go to the sports hall and partake in exercise and things like this. And we've always shied away from releasing the full potential of all of the data because of worries about over-watching
mm-hmm.
what's going on. I don't know whether... When you get a consent, whether there's any way that you can withdraw, or have you thought about nuancing that consent a little bit so that you've got research data that's sort of a little bit more safeguarded, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
So this we can use your performances for marketing. Well, that's maybe okay with them,
mm-hmm.
But then you might not necessarily want some of their early work to be exposed.
Well, that's exactly, yeah, so what becomes public, because obviously with things like performances, it's very identifiable data, but we can't assign just participant IDs or numbers to a performance if their face is in it.
Yeah.
So anonymization of data is particularly challenging when so much of what we have is very identifiable data. Yeah. Absolutely, that gets us into questions around, well, okay, so we're capturing all of this stuff. Some of it's easy to anonymize, so that's not so bad. And as I say, some of the sort of higher order analytics we're doing with our VLE at the moment, everything is so anonymized that it's pretty easy to work with that kind of thing. We're just looking at basic interactions with the VLE, for instance. But yeah, as soon as we get down to using performance videos, that's quite a different animal then. Yeah.
Yeah.
which is partly why we haven't moved to that point yet with the students.
Yes, we have to say no to a proposal that came through that would say to somebody who was just in the refectory thinking of buying the Mars bar that they really should buy the banana instead and go and do some exercise.
I think it links though, doesn't it? So some interesting conversations that are coming out saying more data is not necessarily better data.
No.
And actually, right, you're buying a Mars bar, maybe you actually do better because you need the sugar to do your exam than if you bought a banana, but suddenly you're over-analysing this massive data that you haven't collected for a very specific purpose, and you start to change. But you don't always see the consequences of what you change.
Yeah, there's that issue too. I mean, producing this stuff is one thing, but if it's not being produced with the intent of data, obviously how it's being produced and the format and all the rest of it may not be the most useful format then. But if it's set up for the explicit purposes of research data collection, then does it lose its teaching and learning emphasis then, perhaps? And so how do we marry these two things together to make sure that the teaching and learning objectives are still being met, and yet you're being left with useful, researchable stuff at the end of it?
I think it's also ethically, in terms of what analysis could be applied in the future that might be even more revealing that we don't yet know. So the videos, to me, that there's a lot of interest in programs and algorithms we've developed to automatically detect facial expression, and so you could apply that to those kind of videos because they're quite high enough resolution. Now, how accurate some of those are at the moment is slightly debatable, but that's something that could certainly be applied to any kind of video evidence in the future. So.
Well, that's what we're finding. And that's partly what they tell me project is doing as well, is working on developing some of those algorithms just using basic video footage. So we want to hang on to this stuff.
Yeah.
So that, but again, are the students willing and happy to do that? How do we anonymize it so that we can do those kinds of things? Is it useful to do those kinds of things?
Yeah.
It's just because we can do something doesn't necessarily mean we can or we should, or that it's.
Well, yeah. It's also the consent they give now. It's like, well, you can't predict, but well, we might be able to do something really different in the future with this data. To retrospectively go and ask them again. There's a kind of,
can you future-proof consent?
Well, it's an issue we have with a lot of our stuff as well, because you're collecting massive digital data about people, and you often don't realise how revealing that is until further to actually see it.
It's raising more questions than answers.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm from Cambridge. My name is Melissa Sparpay. I work in the Faculty of Education. We have a few Cambridge people here, so if I'm not able to answer questions, because this is quite a collaborative presentation, then please feel free. Actually, I probably, due to time, won't open it up for questions afterwards, but please see us. We'll be here through the day, at lunch, those sorts of things. So again, this is a collaborative presentation that was initially given at the Engaging research data management conference at St. Catherine's College. And we've added some slides to it because through the GIST Data Champion grant, we've been able to do some activities and get some information from that very, very informal, not highly sophisticated data, but interesting data nonetheless. So I will go ahead and start. This is the brief history, basically, of how the Data Champions came to be at Cambridge. And before the GIST grant came out, actually, we'd already had Data Champions in place. So it's a really lovely partnership with GIST then to be able to do the Data Champions for both sides. So we have a lot of students, 18,000 coming from all over the world. There's 11,000 staff, 31 colleges, and we have 150 departments, faculties, and schools. So there's a lot of data going, you know, in and out of Cambridge that is being collected there as well. We have this wonderful Office of Scholarly Communication that, if you'll see this number, was approximately 20 staff in there managing multiple aspects of data and information for the university. So as you can see, that might be quite a job to do, right? So we had a big problem, this being there was a high demand for training. What is open access anyway? Research, data management, trainings, those sorts of things. Needed to raise the awareness of the importance of these aspects across the community. And there being a wide variety of disciplines at Cambridge, and obviously how that data looks in one department is not similar necessarily to how data looks or is obtained or kept in another department. There were obviously limited resources, and so this seemed like mission impossible in the office. So the solution was that we had these three people, Rosie, Marta, and Danny, all decided there's got to be a different way. We can't be everywhere at one time. So how about we ask the researchers in the departments to advocate about good data management practices, and to share this within their own community of fellow researchers. This would allow for them to give us information, which then we distribute within our own faculty, schools, and departments. So, who are the data champions? So, when I'm speaking of this, it's the Cambridge ones, not the GIST grant. But we have, as you can see, the majority of the disciplines that are data champions are the clinical and biological sciences. And then we have humanities and social sciences, physical sciences, here external technology, but largely it was clinical and biological. And then we've got what were the roles of those data champions? The roles were largely postdocs. Which when I tell you the data that we have in our table, this makes sense when you see the outcomes of our deliverables. So the large majority were postdocs, and we've got some students, PIs and lecturers, and data professionals taking up the majority of that chart. So we wanted to be able to say, this is how data champions came about at Cambridge. So what have we learned so far? So at the Office of Scholarly Communications, they found out that there were quite a lot of suggestions for coming from the data champions on what we need from them to help us in our functions in the departments and faculties. As you can see here, this is the wish list. So, you know, we always like food, that's always a good one. But we really do like bite-sized emails, right? Everybody gets bombarded. We would like easy access to the research data management tools, data management plans. We have lots of electronic lab notebooks have been developed, shared, and utilized. As you can see here, these are, you know, some of the things that we've encountered are people don't know how to just manage their data in a research project. It seems sometimes there's not one person that feels it's their actual job responsibility to organize files and data. A lot of people, especially probably the senior lecturers and professors, don't necessarily like change. And so just overcoming some of these obstacles is what we as data champions are trying to achieve. Fair research. So this again is another topic, and there's a lot of people that are really hesitant because they don't want the confidentiality agreement between the participants. They don't want that breached. They might have a lack of control over the way the data is used if they allow the data to be available. What about the permissions and the ethical concerns that we have as researchers? And then we look here, and this is the wish list. Again, you do get more citations the more that you have your data on the web and in repositories for use. We are also trying to explain that there are solutions to sharing the data. And then there are specific problems about not sharing data. And making sure that we are transparent scientists and that the data and the research that we do can be replicated. That's what good science is, right? Okay. So there was an evolution of data champions that we've moved beyond over time, this research data management, to come up with trainings regarding research data management. It often works well when there's a local expert and there's an infrastructure of support. And then it expanded into incorporated boring RDM into interesting courses for staff at the university, promoting the electronic lab notebooks and promoting being a fair researcher. And I actually think using the term fair rather than open, for instance, has really brought more people on board to the idea of allowing their data to be open and out there for use. So we have this structure already in place at Cambridge where we had data champions, but then there was the call from GISC for the DISC data champion. And so we've had four of those at the university. These, I won't call out everyone's name, but we do have Andy in the back, and I'm sure would be happy to talk with you at lunch, as well as myself. And I believe Anne-Marie is on the live feed right now. So Sergio is at the university. He does a lot in terms of really university-wide data champion activities, which is very interesting because it's a bit of a different beast than going into your own department and trying to really raise awareness about these good practices. He's done a phenomenal job with that. So some of the issues that linger, it seems, are underrepresentation of humanities researchers as data champions. There is still a lack of interest support from senior staff, a variable amount of time to get researchers together. No one has time. Obviously, everyone is quite busy, and so to nail down the right duration of seminar presenting to, as well as just getting a date that works for more people, can be quite challenging. Also, there's a need for professionals within the department. So these data stewards, it's a potential way that departments and faculties and schools, as well as colleges, can actually have one person that is their sole position. And they are responsible then for data management, fair research within that department. I'm just curious, how many of you have data stewards? Anyone? So a person that is on staff at the department or the faculty, that's their primary. primary responsibility. That's a big wish list item, I think, at least for the Faculty of Education. So what is the future? So we would like to have direct involvement with more researchers. Development of research data management solutions to address each one's needs, training opportunities from Cambridge, and just international collaborations, always welcome. And they would like to say at OSC that they are looking forward to working with you. And I would say that all the champions are very, we're all approachable, interested in new ideas and topics and ways that we can brainstorm to try to perhaps overcome some of the hurdles that we have found in our own experiences. So, some of these are, well, these are the schools that are represented in the Data Champions activities. And we have here the forums, workshops, tutorials, seminars. We also provide one-on-one meetings. We have mentoring schemes. And some research has been done, actually, by Data Champions in the schools. So those are various ways that we've been able to get information out and meet with people about their data within our departments or schools. And this is Sergio's slide, because I just wanted to show, I'm going to show some tables in a moment, but I wanted to take his out separately because this is quite, again, university-wide activities. So when I give you the data, it's departmental. It's what are we doing when we're in our own departments and we're trying to get people to come to our seminars and sit with us and talk about best practices for our data. As you can see, these are lots of activities that Sergio has been doing and are very well attended. So I wanted to put these up here so you might see something that you think would work well in your institution or your department. And I know he's also been working with, I'm not sure exactly who he collaborates with, but just having ORCID seminars and workshops on how to keep all of your projects together and then have that ORCID ID perhaps on your website or on your profile. So that's another example of things that he has been doing. So here is some of the data. So this is related to Cambridge Data Champions. And you'll see some correlations basically between the Cambridge Data Champions results and the GIST Champions. Essentially, you can see that I've put how many times each activity has occurred. And then we've got how many members were in the audience. So obviously, one-on-one mentoring, just one person attending, right? Then I have notes. So this asterisk means missing data. That is one of the next steps. Future research should try to get the data champions to provide more data. Because without the data, then we don't really know how it's going. How are these projects working in the departments? So we have things going on, such as embedded teaching. We've got workshops and talks. These ones are specifically related to data management. These can be a wide range of topics. We have the one conference, well, not just one, but one large one recently in engaging researchers. We've got the research going on, and then other. And other range from multiple emails being generated and responding to some other informal sessions. So you can see the numbers of people, and again, probably quite low, I would say, when you consider how many people are doing research at Cambridge. Okay, so next, this is the GIST Data Champions table, and you can see that we've, again, I've put in how many times these activities have occurred, and then the average number of people that have been attending these particular activities. And then I wanted to specifically write out, so this average is a bit skewed because of Andy back there. So you can see that these are pretty normal numbers, this 3, 4, and 4 participants. The 30 is really outstanding, and I'd like to say that I would love for 30 people to attend one of my workshops or talks. And the reason that happened, Andy shared with me, is because he jumped into an already existing seminar series to present his information. I think that's a great tip. If there's already something going on, people are already attending. And if you can get into that, that support system and also the structures already there, the people are already attending, perhaps it will make a huge difference, as you can see, obviously statistically significant, right? Okay, then we've got brown bag lunches. So this was something that I did. I thought, well, no one ever has time, but we all have to eat, so perhaps this will get people there. And I can honestly tell you, it still does it. essentially, I think if maybe I purchased the food and brought it in, maybe I would get a few more, but you can see my average is quite low still, 4.7. And this BYOD is not bring your own drinks, it's bring your own data, and that's Anne-Marie. And actually, her first session, as you can see, was, I mean, in my opinion, is quite well attended, especially for a first session. And I would like to say that in all of these sessions, nearly 100%, possibly 100% feedback. Excellent. They love the information. They want those slides so they can have them and reference back to them. People want this. I think it really does come down to what are the barriers, and perhaps that's something we can discuss at lunch to overcome and try to get people there. And then we've got these one-on-one sessions that have occurred 8 different times. So basically, I just wanted to make a note that usually it ranges somewhere between 3 to 7 attendees. So you're talking about a handful of people, but I believe that we could look at the data and brainstorm and perhaps build that number up. That is not the way it looked when I made this slide. I can talk you through it. Basically, we just wanted to say that there is generally low attendance, but the feedback has been immensely and overwhelmingly positive. And this is something that everyone really, when they do attend, they do love it. I have many people who have returned to mine. So I have 2 particular PhD students that if I talk about data, they are there. So I've had some invited talks that aren't related to my brown bag research group meetings, and they have shown up there as well. So that's good. And yeah, I think that was it for that. Yeah. So thank you very much.
Anyone has any questions for Melissa?
Yes.
I wonder if you have any idea or even evidence that attendance or is different or the appeal is different if you teach an REM session or it's taught by a researcher rather than by a library person, because you know, talk from a different point of view.
So I don't know if we've had, do you know the date on that? So I'm deferring here. So I know that Anne-Marie is doing research, Andy's doing research, I'm doing research, and Sergio is a researcher. So the 4 of us that are just data champions are all in the line of research, so we don't have comparative data really on that. What about for the overall Office of Scholarly Communications?
It's slightly different because I guess we put on training courses and people sign up to come, so it's more of a self-selected bunch than you're kind of putting it on and seeing if there's interest. I think when we do sometimes present with the data champions, so Anne-Marie and Martin together, and I think the attendance was, I think maybe had 3 or 4 people still to that, so it seems, I think when we've done kind of an ad hoc turn up at lunchtime, so we still have low attendance, you guys have low attendance. Yeah, so that's all really anecdotal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it would be interesting to look into more with our data champions.
It would be very interesting to hear that, absolutely. I just don't have that data. Yes.
Have you tried going along to other people's research presentations and asking them about their research data as a question at the end?
Oh.
How accessible is your research data?
No, I'm not giving that approach a go. That's an interesting way to get the conversation started, for sure. I haven't. Andy, have you?
No, really. those kind of things, yeah, actually questioning people's research, either
so have you got a record of the number of those sort of open pledges that have been made by people at Cambridge? Has that been?
I don't.
Oh, personally.
We have a group full of most fanatical open research fans, but that's going to be a big meme. They're very keen on open research, and so they did a campaign called Bullies Into Bad Science. And they tried to get support for people who felt like they had researched and been bullied into publishing in the journal they didn't want to, or you know, chasing the Nature paper on the science thing. So there are a few of them who started that research, so I guess having a look to see who signed their petition would be interesting.
Yes.
So we're at in the process of getting people on board and making their work openly accessible. And we've got lots of support because we're looking at it from an international and a really open access repository. But I'm really worried that although that support is there, whether they'll actually go on and do it. So I was wondering, from those who are really interested in and sort of attend all the seminars and things like that, or have done, and are very pro open access, do you know how many of those actually populate your research data management repository within Cambridge?
So that is another great question. I will say that for me personally, a lot of the people that attend my seminars are PhD students or postdocs. And they actually, when they finally understand, oh, the light bulb comes on, what open research is, and there's these repositories, they immediately want to go on and search for data they can use. But the people that actually have the data, I don't think you would find, at least from the Faculty of Education, there's a lot being put up on the web. Hopefully that will change. What about from Maine, the whole of the university?
I think that's quite a difficult question to answer because we recommend subject-specific repositories where possible. So there are a whole host of people who never come to us. What we do see is kind of year on year, the number of data that's
one of our champions wasn't able to make it, so I will take over and talk to you about our research data shared service. I'm thinking that everyone knows what GIST does. Yes? Okay, good. So I like this slide because it puts all our developing projects in context. So in GIST we have three different departments or directions, I'd say, and two of them are delivering services that are live and launched and developing and strong, and one department which is Digital Futures, which is where our team is actually looking at new ideas or working with the sector to develop something that responds to a need or a requirement, complying with requirements from funders and so on. So we have a few different paths or directions, and the team I'm part of is research. So we do, we're trying to launch some services that are dealing or supporting researchers, and Research Data Shared Service is our biggest project at the moment. In other areas, we have learning analytics and digital capabilities, which you might have heard of, and this is supporting teaching and learning. So why did we decide to do a shared service in research data? Well, we talked a lot with funders, with universities across the UK, and we found out that a lot of the universities, they want to do something about research data. They want to support their researchers, but sometimes either they're unable or there are other priorities, or they don't think that they can provide a high quality support or as higher quality as there are other services that they're offering. And also a lot of the times they have identified that, well, while we could do it, we might not have the expertise from the start, so we won't be able to engage researchers to such an extent. So as a result, we were thinking, okay, so let's try and do something that would be useful for all types of universities. And I guess another reason that we wanted to do it is because the institutions that are providing some support around research data management, perhaps they're providing the different tools, but they are a lot stuck around connecting those tools. So their researchers end up doing or having to do a few things multiple times, or not knowing that they have to do something else. So what I'm referring to is preservation. So a lot of the times the assumption is, well, I put my data in a repository and that will be available for the next 10 years. That's not necessarily the case because of the file formats and changing software that won't necessarily be upgraded to, I don't know, the newest format. So if you open a file from 10 years ago, you might not be able to read it on the current operating system or the current tools that you have. So our goal was to take all these tools that universities are already using and try to connect them so that the actual logistics or the admin burden, I don't know, for lack of a better word, on universities and on the researchers is actually less. So this is a very complicated slide, but it just shows what the different modules that we're trying to put together in the Research Data Shared Service. So there are really three bits to it. So one is a repository, so where you would deposit data. That would be the interface that the researcher would access. I think some of you have seen or have done the user acceptance testing. Then in the background, or the admins would have access to a preservation system, so the data uploaded to a repository would automatically go into the preservation system. Everything will be done, so you don't have to worry about it. All an admin or a super user would have to do is check the preservation system that nothing has gone wrong, and if something has gone wrong, do some re-uploading. And the last bit is the reporting. So a reporting would extract data from these two systems and give some sort of dashboard or a list of analytics for the institution to be able to understand, are we doing well with managing our data, with depositing our data, how much is open, how much is embargoed, how much is preserved, and so on. So very small, I know you can't see this, but we're a big team at the moment supporting the project, and we're hoping, we're working not only with people in GIS, which is this little
box, but we have hired consultants, so technical architects that are helping us build the service. We have a project management support, and we work with a host of other organizations that are providing the different tools. So what we have done so far, and what you might have seen already if you've done the champions, and some of the champions have done the user acceptance testing, is we've put together two of the systems, so the repository with a preservation. And what that means is that if you're a pilot institution, you have one of these, so you either have Fiction or Samvera. Samvera is open source, or you have, and for preservation, you've picked Preserve or Archive. So when you upload the data on the preservation, the alpha minimum viable product is that all the data is automatically ingested into the preservation system, all the preservation actions or the workflows to make sure that the data is available and good to go for the next 10 years or then. So that's the first bit of a service that we have worked on. We are working with 16 pilot institutions, so all these institutions are currently onboarded and they're trialing out the system. Some of it is working, some of it is not, and that's what we're doing right now. We're making sure that in the next 6 months the service will be up and running as well as possible. So that would be the end-to-end, so the idea behind the end-to-end service would be once we have the a repository preservation, we are adding over a layer of reporting so that as an institution you have an overview with what's happening with your research data. And we're working with Lancaster University on the DMA online for the reporting bits. So the idea would be that the service is a bit of a plug and play, right? So if you have other tools and systems within your institution or within the different disciplines, then perhaps you should be able to easily plug it into the service. So data is being uploaded or ingested from other tools like CRIS systems, so current research information systems and other repositories. So this is a slide that shows a little workflow summary. So the biggest bit, I don't know how technical you guys are, but the biggest bit of the research data shared service is the messaging layer. So that is how the data or files are being transferred or ingested, copied over from one system to another. So that's how we're interlinking all the tools that are part of the research data shared service. So that's just another workflow. The other bit that's holding together the research data shared service, you can't see it here, but this is the metadata. So we've developed a metadata schema that is aligning with a metadata from data site, so what's being used quite widely. And we've put it across the service. So for example, when the service is going to be launched, the idea is this, that when the service is going to be launched, if there's another tool that we would be integrating with or that is interested in plugging into our research data shared service, then we would have to align the metadata so that anywhere that data is coming from, it's compatible. So it actually creates that common list of fields, common language, that data can be easily ingested.
and that's linked to the data model. So if you're interested in finding out, you can have a look. And we're working on three different offers at the moment, so you will be able to get the end-to-end service, which I've shown, or the repository only, or the preservation only bit of the service. So that's it for research data sharing. If you have any questions, I am happy to answer. Otherwise, we'll go to the next session, which is more interesting.
Stating we've not done it yet.
Sorry?
We've not done it yet.
Any questions? No. Cool. All right.
Just one mic.
Oh yeah, we've got another mic.
No. Are you moving a lot?
No.
No. Well, you can just move one. Shall we?
Yeah. Okay.
I'll skip you.
So you can come back. I'll just set you up.
Oh, we can hold it. That's
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shall
I just stand
up as well? I'm not sure how to do it. Okay, good afternoon. My name is Jude Powers, here with David Ellis from Lancaster University. We're both data champions. I think our presentation looks slightly different, but I think links to all of the things that have been brought up. So especially issues about open data and the new agenda. I think lots of the things we're working on is pushing in exactly the opposite direction to that. Lots of issues around what is data, and what counts, how are we collecting it, and then I think some of that also links back to how do we get people to engage when we're talking the same kind of language. So we're going to do some quick introductions. I'm going to talk kind of at a more meta level, if you like, a bigger overview, and then David's got some really specific examples to illustrate what we mean. So who are we? I'm a social scientist. I sit in the sociology department at Lancaster. I'm still relatively rare in that I use quantitative data, but I'm in a social science department, so I think Lancaster has one of the biggest sociology departments in the country, and there are four of us who use quantitative data at the moment. I work with crime data, so Crime Survey for England and Wales, but I also do a lot of work with the police, and that's a very specific set of issues around data and data management. And I also do quite a lot of teaching, so I do some methods teaching, especially for our postgrads, and I teach about violence across the curriculum, which also brings with it its own set of issues around how do you think about data and data management.
My name's David. I'm a lecturer in computational social science, but I sit in a psychology department, and my background is in psychology. But generally my work tends to be split across sort of psychology, computer science, and medicine, which is a really weird place to sit, but there it is. Most of the work that I do, similar to sort of Jude's in some ways, you know, it's messy, a lot of the data, and it's often data that's from our digital existence. So that jumps from the data that's on your smartphone through to the data that might be recorded every time that you visit the doctor, for example, on a digital medical record. So I'll come on to those examples.
So I wanted to start with this question about what counts as data. And I think when we were in Cambridge last year, there was a really interesting discussion that started around this. And I think from my perspective, sitting in a Faculty of Arts and Social Science is one of the most important questions. And I think we go from one extreme to the other. So the first time I met anyone from our Data Science Institute and explained what I did, which is I work with large-scale survey data, police recorded crime data, I was told that I didn't have data and it didn't count as data. So they weren't interested in talking to me because I didn't do data. And at the other extreme, I've talked to plenty of social scientists and people in arts and humanities who say they don't have any data.
And I think at Cambridge what was really interesting was that conversation that came out about, well, what counts as data, and how do you converse about data management with people who think they don't have data. So as a minimum, I would say most people think data is quantitative. And so kind of that's a really important message, I think, to get out. So we're really interested in talking about collection, use, and management of data in all of the different forms. And in particular, David and I work a lot with what we call field data. So me from policing, David from health, and you're also going to talk about the reputation crisis. So one of our questions is, why bother with data? In particular, why bother with messy data? And this is a conversation that I have a lot with my students. And I think really excitingly, it's a conversation that we start to have more interestingly on a lot of picket lines over the last 4 weeks. People returning to this idea about, what's the academy for? What do we do? How do we research? What are we as in terms of public education? So what's the value of data and the analysis of data and this kind of understanding that it entrenches or contests our understanding of the world? And that we can either accept them, we can't accept it at face value, and you can't dismiss it as of no use. But ultimately, all of us are interested in data because we want to make changes, right? That's the point. That's why we do research, it's why we teach, it's why we want to have good data management. If you don't manage your data well, then you're open to challenge, right? And that can minimize the value of your impact. And I mean impact in a wider sense, I don't mean impact in a rough sense. But to do that, I think we need much better support for academics, for students, for policymakers, for practitioners, and for the general public. And I think part of this data champion role should be that extending reach. Because we need to understand the implications of the construction and the analysis and the management of data. In particular, we talk a lot about presentation of data, how manipulative the presentation of data is. If you look at the same data presented in different ways, and to me that's all part of data management. So we're interested in this because we want to contribute towards a progressive society, the common good, and a public academia. And I think recognising that to some degree all data are messy. I'm a social scientist, so I say all data are socially constructed. I have a lot of arguments with my colleagues in hard sciences, but data are produced by people, right? So in some ways all data are socially constructed. It's an interesting place to start a discussion for people who don't really want to talk about data management. They usually like talking about stuff like this. Concepts and definitions can be wildly different. I work in the field of violence. I could not find you two people in that field who agree on the definition of violence. So how we measure it then becomes incredibly important. I can give you the same question with data to answer it in exactly the opposite way, with plenty of data to prove a point on both sides. Getting data is really difficult, it can be really hard. How do you find the right source? How do you collect it? What about confidentiality and anonymity? They're really important. The consequences of explicitly and implicitly including and excluding sources or people or wherever your data comes from. And what about cleaning data? So this is a conversation we have a lot in social science. Cleaning data is critical, I would say. If you look at homicide data routinely excludes serial killers because it does nasty things to your trends over time. I would say that's a political decision. But it's usually presented as a statistical decision. Crime Survey for England and Wales caps repeat victimisation at a maximum of 5. We've just got them to change the way they measure violent crime in England and Wales because it's incredibly biased against violent crime against women because that's nearly always domestic violence, which is more likely to be repeated. So the decisions that are made that are quite often deemed to be technical, actually when you start thinking about them in other ways, bring on more people who are interested in those discussions. What units of measurement do you use? So in my work, if I measure violent crime using victims, violent crime goes down. If I measure violent crime using crimes, violent crime is going up. Really matters. And I think these are all really important conversations around data that we need to have
more regularly and they draw in different people. And so really, what's our goal? So for me, the goal is to distinguish between the signal and the noise. We know that there's real variation in the world. That's what we're interested in. We want to know what the variation is and why it happens. And we also know that there's this noise caused by random variability. It's probably caused by the process of collecting and using data, such as measurement or sampling or human error. But also with this caveat that data and data management practices need to keep evolving their dynamics, a dynamic process. So what today might well be random variation, tomorrow, actually, you could come up with a really good explanation. Or techniques could change in a way that take out some more of that random variation and start to change how you think about the data that you've got. So understanding what the goal of that data is and why data management really matters, I think, is got to be at the heart of those conversations that we start to have with people. And that's because, you know, I think, Andy, you almost had this exact phrase. The goal is to expand current knowledge, right, to improve understanding of particular issues. And data is not a one-directional process. You have to go backwards and forwards. Data only makes sense inside a context, and it should go back into that context to improve understanding. So it's an iterative process. It's not a one-way process. And I think making that clear is really important. You can't just do it once. You have to keep going back and doing things more over and over to keep improving that knowledge base. I'm going to hand over to David now for all the specific examples.
Yeah, so this, I'm just going to talk about a couple of examples that sort of build on a lot of things that Jude's already mentioned. And it's just from current work over the last few years that as a data champion, we've tried to kind of, in some ways, it often involves wrestling against what's normal, what's expected. So this is an example of a publication that basically looked at patient-level data from about 500,000 people. And to cut a long story short, it looked at factors that would result in people missing medical appointments. This graph just shows you that lots of people miss multiple appointments. That's the level of detail we're going to talk about. But this kind of data is fundamentally complicated. This isn't my diagram, this is an NHS diagram. But a lot of this data that exists out there with the NHS, it was never really designed to be used in this way, the same crime data as well. It was sort of collected, but it was never really thought that it would be used on the scale that researchers are now able to use it. So that's one complication. The second complication is that this data will never in a million years be publicly available, unless there is some massive change in policy. You could actually argue that some of the data, you know, does someone turn up to an appointment or not? Is that sensitive? It's not linked to other things. But the way it stands at the moment, there's no way we'd be able to dump 500,000 patient records onto a server. Which means that, I think the person who talked at the start, you know, it's well, how do you then make that open? Because that's not going to be open. It's also further complicated the fact that within medical journals, a lot of people who are reviewing the work are not coders. So there's basically a kind of halfway house that you have to not only, or what we've been trying to do is provide both code and also provide diagrams to show what that code does at different points. Now, I appreciate this, you're not meant to read this, it's messy. But this is actually the data pathway of getting from one raw medical record to knowing whether someone actually turned up at an appointment or not, and then bringing in all that patient data. This actually took longer than the writing of the paper itself. But this is really important for people when they're reviewing the paper and don't know the code. Now, I just want to give an example of why this is really important. One of the things that we found in this data is that the NHS didn't actually code for whether someone turns up or not. They do code for it, but it's coded in quite an odd way. So what they code for is a zero. These are just appointments. And if you imagine this times, sort of, I think it was X million appointments, but they just code it as zero, so there's no time in, no time out. And someone looking at this might go, right, that's fine, that's not an appointment, this is an appointment. But again, all this data is created by people. And these times here, the arrival time, the end time, the out time, they're based on when a doctor opens a medical record or closes a medical record or when someone checks in. And so again, you could just look at this and assume that's fine, and you know, someone could look at this data, similar data in the future, and just apply that code. But actually what we found is it was a bit more complicated than that, because we were interested, by pure coincidence, we were also looking at the average wait time, so this is the difference between this time, and the average appointment time. And if you calculate those two numbers for every appointment and you plot them,
you should get a positive relationship, right? You should look like a scarecrow. This is what it actually looks like, complete insane mess. Now, this is not something that we can include in the publication. We can't put the data in there, so we have to make sure that we explain to people in a supplementary material that the reason this happens is because doctors open medical records and forget to close them. So they're open for hours and hours. It's also because people appear and then leave, and some of it we just don't know. But this actually, these negative areas here actually represent quite a small percentage of all the appointments. But this is really important if someone was to come back and redo the similar analysis. So essentially in this example, we've tried to make the code as user-friendly as possible, rather than, because we just can't put the data up there. What we can do is we can provide sort of made-up sample data that replicates these problems as well. But it is a constant struggle to make sure that this is available. And to be honest with you, and I'll come back to this in a minute, publishers to me don't seem as interested in this as they potentially could be. I think particularly within medicine, this is not something that was asked for by 5 reviewers, it wasn't something that was asked for by an editor. They just were interested in that this is interesting because. As a psychologist, I don't think I can stand here and not mention the huge issues psychology has, particularly social psychology has, within replication. And that applies to both the collection of data, where that data is stored. For people who don't know, I'm sure if you just Google the words replication crisis in psychology, you'll get a lot of interesting material about how stuff holds up. Now, there is a move towards more and more psychologists putting the data online, but a lot of that data is functionally useless. And similarly, people often will say, oh, but, you know, I'd say a lot of professors say this, oh, my data is available and it's online, and you can get it if you email me. This is just the results of a study from a few years ago showing that if you email people to get data, very few often reply. So people are now, there is definitely a move towards more people putting their psychological data online. But when you look at it, it's often totally unusable. Similarly, within psychological publication, things are presented in a way that journals want. And within my domain of, sort of social psychology, that often involves tables. So this is a... And that's not necessarily ideal in terms of explaining a result to someone. This is just a kind of figure to show you that in terms of all this open data within social science, there's always different levels you can look at this. So it can go all the way from the, and I base it around Maslow's hierarchy of needs as a psychologist. So, you know, 5's the best, 0's the worst. And of course, at the very top, you can have all the data's open and usable, and people can reanalyze it quite freely. At 1, it might just be a complete data dump of all the experimental data that's completely useless. Ideally, we'd want more of it to get towards the 5. So one of the things I've been doing with a few others as part of a data champion is to try and get away from things like this. So this is a table from a paper that basically built some statistical models to try and predict what type of mobile phone you have in your pocket, whether it's an iPhone or an Android. That's not too important right now, but it's a very classic psychology study that's looking between 2 groups. And often within these journals, you get these tables of numbers that are not particularly useful and they don't help people really understand what's going on in the data. Now, the data is uploaded to Lancaster University's servers because we make the data open. But then what we're also doing is building online applications to help visualize and to help people reuse that data. So this is the one at the top here is basically for this data. So people, you can see here that the data is stored on Lancaster's server. And then people can pick different variables and show the differences between these two groups. So this has actually ended up being used as a teaching aid as much as it has been to explain the results to other people. And people can replicate all our analysis on this to their heart's content. Ironically, I have a sneaking suspicion this has actually been viewed more times than the paper has. So again, coming back to the publisher's role in this, I think there's a real question to be asked about why can these sort of things, which are built on open source code, not be integrated into journal articles directly? If you look at journal articles today, they're basically digital PDFs. They've barely changed since the internet started, which is ironic given that the internet was there to serve academics to begin with, to share. So I find it really frustrating that I basically put a link to this in the paper, and then people have to get to the paper to get to it. I've put the link elsewhere. But I do think there's questions to be raised about these kind of things and why they can't be integrated into other platforms. So I think we'll stop there. But those examples are really just to kind of illustrate the sort of things that Jude was talking about, as well as 2 kind of clear, kind of concrete examples of where you can't share everything, but what can you share? And also, if you can share, what's the maximum level and what benefits might that be able to bring? Thank you. So thanks very much.
Any questions?
As you said, data's messy, right? And sometimes people are wonderful and they reach number five in their career, sometimes they just do a data dump. As someone who kind of does a level of curation of the data that comes into our repository, it's really difficult for me to know whether that's good quality data or not. Do you have any thoughts or kind of experience on how to make sure that the data we
So I would say, so if it gets to the stage of building those online things, there's no choice but to have the data in a reasonable quality, because one, you're basically making it available for everyone to peck away at. So if there was like an extreme outlier in that data, it would look really obvious. So I guess, yeah, some of that, but yeah, generally it would depend on the data that's being deposited. I mean, I think if there's a pathway, like, you know, if people can show the data that's ultimately reported in the paper, and you know, there's a clear link of, well, how did they get to that number? Because you can, you know, within, for example, within psychology, you have someone doing thousands of trials in an experiment and you record a reaction time, but that's, you're not going to report any of those in the paper. You know, it would just be like the average. So is it clear how they, so that to me would be, you know, if you can read it and you understand how I can see how they get to that number, then that to me would be that it's been done well. If it is just a data dump.
Yeah, so I'm quite interested in the visualization. I guess if they dump the data and then you can just click a few buttons and it makes the graph that's
yep.
the same as the
yep.
paper.
Yeah, so that was the idea. And it meant that because we knew we were going to build that at the start, you know, it probably improved the teams, or the research team's like ways of making sure the data was in a sensible order fashion that anyone could understand. And that's quite a simplistic data set. It might be more complicated, but it's doable.
I think part of the agenda, I think you need ground level up buy-in. So if people have to tick a box to get the journal to accept it, they'll probably just give you a data dump because it's quick and it's easy. If people are kind of on board with a public academia kind of idea about openness and data and sharing, then that should change what you get, because it has a different purpose. It's not a tick box purpose, this is going out into the world to do something purpose. And I think that's part of those conversations that we need to have around data.
I think some publishers are responding to it. So, I mean, people like Elsevier have developed like, things like interactive plot viewers, but you have to pay money to use them. So why would they use that one? It's just that would ingrain it into the paper. But I don't know, I'm not aware of any other publishers. I mean, I'm not aware of editors saying, oh, this would be great. It's kind of just an extra.
I've never been asked for data, ever, in any social science journal that I've published.
You could ask a question.
You mentioned sort of security in terms of, so my area is sort of forensic science and sort of crime serving information, but and therefore our repository is also looking to disseminate information gathered from law enforcement and other, any kind of related discipline that might support justice systems, not only criminal but civil, etc. And so regarding the word open, sort of in that context, are there any sort of piece of advice that you would give around what level of open might be acceptable for information in a repository or data that's shared?
Yeah, so in terms of crime data, so for my access for crime data, I went through the same process that any serving officer went through and signed the Official Secrets Act, all of that, on a special laptop. But in the north, we've got the N8 Policing Research Partnership, which is working with the 11 forces and 8 universities across the north, and Leeds University holds a data analytics strand. And one of the conversations we're having there is between the police and academics, somewhere along the continuum is completely secure data that's actually the most useful, through to completely unsecure data but that's aggregated to a point where it's not useful at all. And we're trying to have a conversation about how far along that continuum can you come, and at what's reasonable levels of security at different points along the continuum, and how can you bring in different people with different access along different points? And we haven't got very far yet, but it's the conversation that we're starting to have. So what's secure and what's useful, and how can you bring those two together as far as possible?
I think the same discussion is going on in health as well. So there was some talk of trying to build similar interactive graphics from some of that NHS data, and initially they went mental, well, we can't do that. But then if there's a discussion about, well, what really is underlying that visualization, is it, we're not suggesting the whole entire data set, but where do you draw the line? But there's all, it sounds like Grimes starts further ahead with that than NHS is, because I don't think.
But it's in pockets,
yeah.
I think, as well. So what we've agreed with one police force, another police force will not agree to at all. So there's no overarching agreement across those 47 forces. And I think that's tricky. So also, what the Home Office will agree to, the Ministry of Justice, often is different in their agreements. So yeah, it's a lot of separate conversations and then trying to get people into a room, which is maybe where something like an overarching data agenda actually might progress more than individual research agendas have been able to.
Yeah, any more questions? No? All right. Well, thank you. So we're early. We'll have some lunch. Hopefully the lunch is there. And after, we will come back to hear from Andrea about the research data toolkit, and we'll have a bigger discussion with the research data champions, and followed by drinks. So let's go and see.